Indians, which sparks enthusiasm for the beast and facilitates the movement to venerate his image, was fire coming down from heaven upon the earth in the sight of men. Well, that occurred during the reign of Benedict XVI, the second beast. The image of John Paul II, the beast who was wounded, was seen coming down from the sky in fire in Poland. Many believed it was a miracle. And there are a number of reasons why John Paul II was uniquely significant, why he was indeed the Antichrist. It wasn't just that John Paul II was an antipope of monumental importance, theologically, historically, and culturally. It wasn't just that he was one of the most well-known, photographed, loved, and traveled people in all of human history. It wasn't just that he led millions who claimed to follow the Catholic Church, the only true church, into a Vatican II counter-church of heresy and apostasy. No, in addition to all of those things, the reason John Paul II was the guy, the Antichrist, was that he taught that he and everyone else is Jesus Christ. That's right, John Paul II claimed to be Christ. He claimed to be God, and he did so while sitting in the temple of God. He claimed to be the incarnate Christ, the risen Christ, the Christ of Matthew 16:16, etc., as we proved in our video, John Paul II was the Antichrist. John Paul II's demonic teaching on that point corresponded precisely to Scripture's doctrinal definition of Antichrist in 1 John 4:2-3. John Paul II also taught and exhibited things in the areas of false ecumenism and interreligious apostasy that were not only completely condemned by the Catholic Church, by all true popes, and by sacred scripture, but they were actions and teachings so revolutionary that prior to him they would have been considered unimaginable, coming from an alleged pope. Yet once he did them, once he broke down the barrier and did what had been unthinkable, similar activity became acceptable all over the Vatican II counterchurch. The Vatican II Church, even though it purports to be the Catholic Church, is actually not the Catholic Church as our material proves. There were also literally thousands of false signs and wonders, usually associated with modern-day false apparitions, which were instrumental in spreading fervent devotion to John Paul II. These false apparitions and false signs were consistent with the description in 2 Thessalonians 2:9 of the false signs and wonders that accompany the reign of the Antichrist and the acceptance of the great apostasy. To give just one example of a false sign that accompanied the reign of John Paul II, the Antichrist, the false apparitions of Medjugorje began occurring in June of 1981, only weeks after the assassination attempt against John Paul II. The two events were clearly related. The shooting of John Paul II was an event that plays an important role in Apocalypse 13. It was the wounding of the head of the beast, who is himself also the beast. On the heels of the assassination attempt against John Paul II, false apparitions such as Medjugorje were intended to promote the lie that John Paul II was the one whom evil forces were trying to eliminate, that he was holy, special, and to be followed. That is exactly what the devil wanted people to believe, so that multitudes would accept John Paul II's new false religion and the counter-church which he led. False signs and wonders accompanied the false messages about John Paul II. In addition to all of his other mind-boggling heresies, blasphemies, and apostasy, John Paul II was the man who buried the message of Fatima and defrauded the entire world of the true third secret of Fatima. Even though he was the one who hid the true third secret and foisted a false one upon the world, he, the Antichrist, wound up getting himself accepted as the hero of Fatima. John Paul II also taught universal salvation, denied that heaven, hell, and purgatory are places, agreed with the Lutherans on justification, praised the social justice and planning, in other words, abortions, of communist China, partook in the ceremonies of demonic religions, and much more. And then came Benedict XVI, Joseph Ratzinger, the man who exercised all the power on behalf of, or in the sight of, John Paul II, when he was head of the CDF under John Paul II, exactly as it says in Apocalypse 13:12. It says that the second beast exercised power in the sight of, or on behalf of, the first beast, whose wound was healed, and that this second beast, who exercised all the power in the sight of the first beast, causes people to worship the image of the first beast, whose wound was healed. Apocalypse 13:11 also says that this second beast comes out of the earth. Benedict XVI's name, Ratzinger or Rat, signifies beast out of the earth in almost all major languages. For in the book of Genesis, the Bible itself defines that beasts of the earth are the land creatures, and there is no better description of a land creature, a beast of the earth, who comes out of the earth, than a rat. and the names of biblical figures frequently signify their role or character. The beast out of the earth is the one who causes people to worship the image of the first beast, whose wound was healed. Benedict XVI's name in Greek, Benedictos, also equals exactly 666, just as it says in Apocalypse 13 concerning the number of the name of the beast. By, quote, beatifying John Paul II and officially declaring him, quote, blessed, Benedict XVI officially approved the worship/veneration of John Paul II's image. And what's so fascinating is that the word here in Greek in Apocalypse 13:12, which is sometimes translated worship or adore, as in the second beast causes people to worship or adore the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed, that word in Greek is proskuneo. That word is the very same word used by the Catholic Church at the Second Council of Nicaea to describe the veneration of the blessed and the saints. Proskuneo can mean adoration in the sense of latria, but it can also mean simply veneration in the sense of the honor given to the blessed and the saints. Indeed, in its dogmatic teaching, the Church uses proskuneo to describe the veneration of the blessed and the saints. In addition, the Greek word for the image of the beast being venerated is eikon. It's the word from which we get icon or image. When we are given the word for the veneration of the blessed and the saints, as well as a description of image/icon veneration, there is an obvious reference to the Church's traditional veneration of the blessed and the saints being perverted in a demonic way by giving this veneration to a devilish figure, a man who claimed to be Jesus Christ, was wounded, was a king of Rome, was the false hero of Fatima, an emperor figure, etc. Benedict XVI's, quote, beatification of John Paul II clearly fulfilled what is written here. This is very interesting. It says that the second beast gives life to the image of the beast. The word for life here in Greek is pneuma, which means breath or animation or spirit. Now, St. John obviously lived before the invention of television or video technology. He had no idea what video footage and television images were. Therefore, if he had a vision of John Paul II, the beast who was wounded, having his image/icon venerated by the second beast, during a ceremony which also featured video footage or televised images of John Paul II moving and speaking, how would St. John describe it? He would describe it as the image or icon of John Paul II appearing to be alive, as being animated, as having life. He would describe video footage as an image with life, an image that even speaks. And in fact, the very next words of Apocalypse 13:15 say, quote, and that the image of the beast should speak, end quote. St. John's description of an image having life and even speaking fits precisely with a vision of video footage, for St. John would hear sounds coming from the television screen and the animated image. And guess what? At the, quote, beatification ceremony of John Paul II, ABC News reported that not only were posters honoring John Paul II's life put up all over Rome, but large television screens showing images of John Paul II were erected along the Roman street that leads to St. Peter's Basilica. The BBC also reported that there was a giant video screen at the, quote, beatification. Quote, St. Peter's Square was transformed for the occasion with a giant video screen showing John Paul II's life story and a massive photograph hung from the white colonnades, end quote. John Paul II was also, quote, beatified on May 1st, the Feast of the Beast for Satanists. Thus, the statement in Apocalypse 13:15 that the second beast gave life to the image of the beast so that the image of the beast should even speak fits precisely with the, quote, beatification of John Paul II and the video of his icon speaking, moving, having life, which was a feature of the beatification ceremony dedicated to his worship. John Paul II's, quote, beatification was the fulfillment of Apocalypse 13:15. After it says that the second beast gives life to the image of the beast and that the image of the beast should speak, which was fulfilled by the, quote, beatification of John Paul II, Apocalypse 13:15 goes on to say, quote, and he should cause that whosoever will not worship the image of the beast should be slain, end quote. The word here in Greek, which is usually translated slain or killed, is from the Greek word apokteno. That word can mean physically kill, but it doesn't always mean physically kill. In fact, to give just one example, in Romans 7:11, St. Paul uses the same Greek word to describe spiritual death or the loss of spiritual life. Benedict XVI, the second beast, indeed fulfilled that part of the verse by imposing the worship of the beast under the pain of the loss of spiritual life. Now, Benedict XVI did impose the worship of John Paul II's image in a number of ways. By officially, quote, beatifying John Paul II, Benedict XVI instituted and permitted, by virtue of his so-called apostolic authority, the cult or worship of John Paul II for October 22nd of each year. Moreover, Benedict XVI's imposition of the worship of John Paul II and his image, under pain of separation from full communion and therefore the loss of spiritual life, was made clear in the negotiations with the Society of St. Pius X. Benedict XVI's negotiations with the Society of St. Pius X were representative of what he was telling all independent, quote, traditionalists. When Benedict XVI made it clear to the SSPX and everyone else that they cannot be considered in, quote, full communion unless they accept Vatican II, the, quote, magisterium of John Paul II, etc., he was saying that unless you worship Vatican II, John Paul II, and his image, you are slain, that is, outside of full communion with the Church. That's how, in addition to formally beatifying the Antichrist, Benedict XVI imposed the worship of the beast. Furthermore, when you consider that formal honor paid to the Antichrist is among the most wicked acts in history, it makes sense that the first major ceremony signifying this honor to the Antichrist, that is, the beatification, would be the most historically significant and evil. For example, every time the Vatican II antipopes go into a synagogue to worship with the Jews, it's an evil act which signifies apostasy. But it was the first time this occurred, when John Paul II worshipped in a synagogue in 1986, which was the most historically significant and evil. In the same way, while all of the interreligious prayer meetings held by the antipopes with false religions in Assisi, Italy, were extremely evil, and they all manifested apostasy, it was the first meeting in 1986 which was the most historically significant, simply because it was the most revolutionary. It was the first time in the sight of God in the world that the so-called leader of Christianity held such an abominable event. The import, the significance, and the affront offered to God by the first event could not, in a sense, be duplicated. That's why the, quote, beatification ceremony, a ceremony which featured 1.5 million people in attendance, and millions more watching around the world, was what St. John saw and recorded concerning the second beast causing people to worship the first beast. It was the first major ceremony in which people formally worshipped the beast, and it could not, therefore, in terms of its significance, be duplicated. And even though a canonization has a binding nature in Catholic teaching that a beatification does not, the, quote, beatification of John Paul II fulfilled what St. John described, because the only thing the beatification lacked, the universal binding nature of the decree, was supplied by Benedict XVI through his negotiations with the Society of St. Pius X. Benedict XVI's negotiations with the SSPX made it clear to everyone that, quote, traditionalists are excluded from full communion with him unless they fully accept Vatican II, John Paul II, his, quote, magisterium, his image, etc. Since the imposition of the worship of the beast was supplied by what Benedict XVI decreed concerning the SSPX, the, quote, beatification lacked absolutely nothing of what St. John prophesied concerning the second beast causing people to worship the image of the first beast, whose wound was healed. Moreover, the celebration for the, quote, beatification, which involved millions, would be comparable to a celebration for the, quote, canonization. In fact, there might even be more enthusiasm for John Paul II's beatification, because it was the first formal recognition of him as, quote, blessed, and many would see the following step of, quote, canonization simply as a formality after John Paul II's cult had already been formally approved. Therefore, since the, quote, beatification was the first major event in which the worship of the Antichrist was formalized, it was the most historically significant and evil. It was what St. John recorded. It's also interesting that the second beast is typically identified as the false prophet, while the first beast, who is wounded and whose image is honored, is identified as the Antichrist. John Paul II, with his Antichrist teaching about man, fits precisely with the title of Antichrist, and Benedict XVI, the second beast, who causes people to worship John Paul II, fits precisely with the title of false prophet. For while Benedict XVI was a monumental heretic, as our material documents, he amazingly retained a reputation as a conservative. He also seduced members of the counterchurch by giving more access to the Latin Mass. This move deceived multitudes. It duped many into believing that there was still hope in the counter-church, and it persuaded people that Benedict XVI was not evil, but good, and that he would perhaps reverse the entire course of the Vatican to apostasy, when in fact nothing could be further from the truth. Benedict XVI was a manifestly heretical antipope, a true theological revolutionary, who expanded the Vatican to apostasy, organized the worship of the beast, and fractured independent so-called traditionalists by making overtures to them on the one hand, pretending to be concerned about tradition, while simultaneously refusing to admit them into his, quote, full communion, without a complete recognition of the evil doctrines of the counter-church. And the reason that what we've covered here, concerning John Paul II as the first beast and Benedict XVI as the second beast who causes people to honor his image, fits so precisely with the text of Apocalypse 13, and no other attempted explanation would even come close to matching the accuracy with which this corresponds to the text, is because this is the fulfillment.